Let us have a look at the procedure to be followed for carrying out the constraint analysis of multi-role military aircraft. First, let us have a look at the typical constraints which are specified on a military aircraft. Mainly they come from the customer requirements. There could be constraints like sustained turn rate at specified Mach number and altitude. A sustained turn rate means the ability of an aircraft to turn at a particular degrees per second in the yaw plane and to maintain that particular turn rate without any loss in speed or loss in altitude. Then you have instantaneous turn rate. This is similar to the sustained turn rate, but in instantaneous turn rate we are permitted to sacrifice either speed or altitude to achieve a turn rate. So, this is a momentary turn rate which cannot be sustained, hence it is called instantaneous, whereas a sustained turn rate is something that you need to maintain. Then maximum Mach number at a specified altitude is the ability to fly at that particular Mach number at a given altitude. One important performance attribute of an aircraft is specific excess power, that is the excess power over power required divided by the weight of the aircraft, okay, or it is also called as SEP. This SEP can be traded to achieve either acceleration or climb or both. So, at a given Mach number and a given altitude, sometimes a specific excess power that needs to be possessed by an aircraft is explicitly specified. Climb rate while operating at a given altitude is another performance parameter. The stalling speed of the aircraft in level flight, so it is 1G stalling speed at a specified weight and altitude. Takeoff and landing ground roll under ISA conditions or under ISA plus X or the off ISA design conditions. Absolute and combat ceilings, once again under other ISA conditions or under specified ISA plus X conditions. These are the typical requirements which the customer specifies. There are also some airworthiness requirements which may be present, and that is a function of the regulatory bodies or the airworthiness agencies which are having a sovereign control over the military aircraft or the domain in which it is operating. So, there is no specific requirement, it is as specified. For a military aircraft, it is easier to look at a master equation for constraint analysis, and this master equation comes from the energy height principles. So, the energy height basically is specific energy or the excess energy divided by the aircraft weight. The energy that an aircraft possesses is the summation of the potential energy and the kinetic energy, that is mgh and half mv square. When you divide that by aircraft weight, you get specific energy. Now, W is equal to basically mg. So, if you you know, do a simple algebraic manipulation, the specific energy turns out to be, the units turn out to be h and v square by 2g. Now, v is in meter per second and g is in meters per second square. So, you know, if you look at the units of the specific energy, they will come in meters. So, that is why we call it as energy height. So, the energy height is equal to h plus v square by 2g. Now, the excess power that an aircraft possesses is basically equal to d by dt of the energy or the rate of change of the energy. So, the excess power, that is t minus d into v, t into v is the power available and t v into d is the power required. So, the excess power is the rate of change of the total energy, and hence the specific excess power will be excess power divided by the weight of the aircraft. In other words, PS, which is the symbol used for specific excess power, it will be P available minus P required divided by W, or V into T minus D upon W, which is also equal to the rate of change d by dt of h plus v square by 2g. So, using this expression, one can actually draw a diagram like this for various values of Ps. This particular diagram is a Ps diagram at n equal to 1, and it kind of gives you some maneuver limit that the aircraft has. We will come back to this in more detail little bit later. So, let us see how we can set up the master equation. A master equation is an equation which will be used to represent the relationship between T by W and W by S, because ultimately in a constraint diagram we are going to plot T by W on the y axis and W by S on the x axis. So, if we can get an equation between these two parameters, then we can use that equation directly to plot the constraint diagram. So, it can be shown that if you basically take this V in the denominator, you will get T by W minus D by W, that is this expression, is equal to 1 by V dH by dt plus 1 by G V square by 2G. When you differentiate, you get 2V by 2. So, by cancellations, you get this expression. So, this is the basic master equation. Now, we have to also keep in mind that this equation has got terms like T, W, D, V, dH by dt. So, let us see one by one. Let us first look at T. T is the thrust, and the thrust is not constant at all conditions. So, in general, you can say that T is equal to A into T0, where A is the thrust lapse ratio. This represents the change in the thrust compared to the sea level static thrust value. It depends on the density ratio sigma and the Mach number or velocity, as the case may be. So, at any condition, T will be equal to alpha times TSL. Note that alpha can also be more than 1 in case we are using reheat or afterburner, that is normally used in military aircraft during takeoff. So, it is not that the value of A will be always less than 1. In general, the value of A is going to be less than 1 higher altitudes. So, this particular chart or this particular table helps us in determining which is the appropriate equation to be used to calculate the value of TA or the value of TA by TSL will be alpha. So, if we have for example, if we look at high bypass turbofan, we have this expression, and there is a 0.1 here. If you look at a turbojet, for example, it just shows that for turbojet or a low bypass turbofan, the T available is basically equal to the TSL into rho by rho SL. So, it just goes by the density ratio. So, this is a simple simplification of what can be seen in real life, and it helps you to find out the value of the parameter. So, we take care of thrust by multiplying it by alpha. Now, we look at weight. Now, weight of the aircraft W is always going to be changing as we go into the flight profile. So, in general, weight at any segment, at any point in the performance of the aircraft, will be beta times WTO, where beta is the weight fraction for a given constraint. Regarding drag, drag can be replaced by CD into Q into S, and if we assume a parabolic profile for the drag polar, we can replace CD with CD naught plus K1 CL square. Now, the lift coefficient is going to be N times W. So, the lift is going to be N times W. Therefore, CL will be equal to L upon QS, which will be N times W upon QS. So, this is the basic master equation that we have derived. Now, what we can do is, we can replace the D with CD naught plus KCL square into QS. We can replace CL by NW by QS. We can replace W by beta times WTO, and we can replace T by alpha times TSL. So, if we do that, then what you get will be as follows. So, T will become alpha times TSL upon W will become beta times WTO minus D will become CD naught plus K1 CL square into Q into S upon W will become beta times W takeoff, and that will be equal to 1 by V dH by dt plus 1 by G dV by dt. Now, since CL is equal to NW by QS, the CL square here can be replaced by N square W square by Q square S square. So, when you do that, you will get here N square. Now, W is going to be beta, so beta square W 0 square and divided by Q square S square. So, this Q S will go and it will become upon Q and S. Okay. And then what we can do is you can take this alpha by beta common. So, long story short, if you substitute in the above expression all the values and if you take out the terms common, you get an expression TSL by WTO, which is the LHS, is going to be beta by alpha Q by beta CD naught by WTO by S in plus K1 N beta Q by Q whole square WTO by S plus the same RHS side. So, what happens here is that on the LHS you have TSL by WTO, on the RHS you have WTO by S in the denominator here, WTO by S in the numerator here, and you have all the other parameters. So, one advantage of this particular expression is that there is no need now for you to worry about converting the values from the ones operating or being present at the constraint value to the ground level, because now you are getting directly in terms of TSL by WTO and WTO by S through the values of beta, alpha, and this expression can then be used for calculating any of the constraints specified here except a few. Now, it may be noted that the expression on the RHS 1 by V dH by dt plus 1 by G dV by dt, this is nothing but PS by V, okay, because PS was dH by dt plus 1 by V dV by dt. So, therefore, during study level cruise, we do not have any excess power. So, this whole term is going to be 0. So, therefore, the master equation for cruising flight will convert into an expression as shown here. The terms on the end are going to be 0. So, if you now plot, you can see it is a quadratic relationship, and you can see that on the y axis you have T by W, on the x axis you have W by S for one particular condition, and the line that you see represents the relationship between the T by W and W by S for some particular values of beta, Q, alpha, N, etcetera. Let us look at the constraint on the climb rate. The rate of climb is nothing but dH by dt, and therefore, if I have a steady climb, then there will be 0 value of dV by dt. So, the specified value of dH by dt at the specified climb velocity can be given in this expression to get a link between T, the T by SL. So once again, we have a curve where a max climb rate constraint can be shown in this form, and the area below this line is going to be the infeasible area, the area above this is going to be feasible. Similarly, let us take a constraint on takeoff ground roll. Now, usually specified in the terms of takeoff distance STO. So, if you assume the V takeoff to be 1.2 times V stall, which is the regulatory requirement, then STO is equal to, because VTO is 1.2 times V stall, you have a factor of 1.2 square or 1.44. So, therefore, what will happen is that the T by WTO will be coming as a straight expression. These items are going to be, so for a given STO, for a given altitude, for a given CL max in takeoff, you should be able to get a direct link between the T by W and W by S. So, this is going to be a linear line, and the area below this line is going to be infeasible because that will not meet the specified takeoff value. Let us look at the landing distance constraint. The landing the speed at which you touch down is normally expected to be around 30% higher than the stalling speed. So, with that, an expression for landing distance can be obtained. This 1.69 comes from 1.3 square, and because during landing there is going to be some friction, there is some rolling friction and some drag during landing, these terms mu roll and d land also appear in the calculation. But in some cases one can ignore d land and l land, so you get a much simpler expression, and this simpler expression simply allows you to look at landing distance as a function of only the w by s. So it will be actually a straight line, because all the other quantities can be assumed to be constant for a given operating condition. So, it is basically W by S is a function of the landing distance. So, it puts a upper limit on W by S. If I want to have a landing distance below a particular number, I cannot have wing loading higher than a particular number. Thanks for your attention. We will now move to the next section.